After a very detailed introduction to telecom, let's begin our actual technology journey. The fundamental building block in telecom is signaling. We will look at what we mean by signaling and why this is required. We will then look at various basic types of signaling in the subscriber side and also the network side. The subscriber signaling will be divided into analog access and digital access. At this point, we will trace a typical call flow to make the understanding easier. The network signaling will again be classified into analog network signaling and digital network signaling. We will go on to explain some very important concepts like channel associated signaling and common channel signaling. We'll see in detail an analog network signaling called MFR2. We will reinforce what we have seen thus far with a series of call flow stages. We'll move on to look at digital signaling then. Two standards universally popular are the T1 and E1 standards. Let's begin our journey by exploring signaling to start with. In this slide, let us look at what do we mean by signaling. Signaling is a method used for the switching offices and the CPE to control the switching of calls over the transmission facilities such as wires, radios, etc. in the PSTN domain, that is public switched telephone network domain. Refer to the figure. Signaling is a generation, transmission and reception of information needed to direct and control the various stages of a call flow. What are the stages? Call setup, monitor the call, maintain the call, disconnect the call and bill the call. All these are part of signaling. What are the different classifications of signaling? Refer to the figures. The signaling are classified according to the internal signaling of an exchange, signaling between two exchanges, signaling between an exchange and the subscriber. What are the two types of signaling? Channel associated signaling and common channel signaling, CAS and CCS. In CAS, signaling is on the same channel as the telephone call. Whereas in CCS, signaling is on a separate channel dedicated for that purpose and voice is in a different channel. Voice is different and signaling is different. That is CCS for you. What is a signaling system? A signaling system is the one which interconnects a variety of switching systems, transmission systems and subscriber equipments in a telecommunication network. What are the different kinds of signals involved in signaling? First one, supervisory signals or line signals. These are the signals which initiate a call, progress a call, maintain the call and supervise it once the call has been established. It's also referred as subscriber loop signaling or line signaling. Examples, off hook, on hook, ceasing the line, billing, all these things form supervisory signals or line signals. The next one is routing signals or register signals. These are related to transfer of information related to call setup. Examples can be dialed digits, it can be pulses or DTM of tones. The basic information is the dialed code which indicates to the subsequent switching centers the required routing. Other examples are route information, terminal information, register control signals, acknowledgement signals, status of call terminals and so on. The third type could be management signals or inter-register signaling. These signals are related to exchange of information and control between exchanges on trunks. This signaling is also known as inter-exchange signaling. This signaling deals with remote switching of private circuits, complete routing information between exchanges, primarily meant for end-to-end user connection, congestion control, priority of the call, class of service, and so on. This signaling can be either on a link-by-link basis, that is from one exchange to another exchange, or on a end-to-end basis, that is between originating and terminating exchange. These are the three types of signaling that are possible. Let us look at why signaling is required. If we do not have signaling, we need to connect everyone with everyone else through direct wires. Look at the figure. In this figure, a group of 5 users would need 10 connections to talk to each other. Imagine they are in different cities and realize how unmanageable it can be. If there are 100 such users, we need 100 C2, that is 100 into 99 divided by 2, that would be nearly 5000 direct connections. Very formidable, is it not? Let's look at this figure that's appearing on your screen now. The typical telephone pole would have looked like this and eventually would fall down. Ridiculous, is it not? Okay, then why do we need signaling? The main reasons are, signaling is required, as we have stressed very often, to establish a communication path between two users irrespective of where they are located. Within the same area or between two cities or two countries, they could be anywhere. The second purpose is, having established a call, the network should continuously monitor and ensure that the connection is maintained throughout the conversation. The third purpose, the moment one of the users disconnects, the entire circuit should be released so that some other user may use these circuits. Delay in release means wastage of resources and also inaccurate or excessive billing. Fourth, estimate the exact call duration and bill accordingly so that the revenues are taken care of. The billing amount should be neither more nor less. It should be exact. So these are the purposes for which signaling is required. Other enhanced requirement of signaling are to determine the facilities required, that is bandwidth, speed, etc. for a particular call. Second one, add supplementary functions to enhance the user's experience such as caller ID, call waiting, special ringtones and so on. Third purpose, carry additional signaling information like charging, routing, etc. The fourth one can be build error detection and error correction based on the type and nature of the calls. Any other reasons you can figure out why signaling is required? A modern telephone network such as a PSTN with automatic switching requires signaling. The present PSTN has got thousands of features and all of them require signaling support. Let us summarize by looking at some of the examples of signaling activities. On-hook, off-hook, pulse dialing, tone dialing, receiver off-hook, ringing the called party, providing ring-back tone to the calling party, call waiting, caller number identification, call forwarding, hook flash, fax transmission detect, echo cancellation, voicemail, audio conference calls, video conferencing, coin drop, billing, and so on and on and on. Signaling provides the interface between different national systems and different standards. For example, between telephony network and internet. I am sure by now the readers understand why signaling is so important as the backbone of telecom network. In this slide, let's look at several signaling types. We know that signaling is a generation, transmission and reception of information needed to direct, monitor and control the setup and also to disconnect a call. We have seen all this. There are two groups of signaling methods, user-to-network signaling and network-to-network signaling. What is user-to-network signaling? This is also called end-user-to-exchange signaling. Two examples, DTMF, that's a dual-tone multi-frequency dialing, and BRI and PRI in ISDN. We'll see about this later on. This is a signaling between the user and the local exchange over the local loop or access lines. The second one, network-to-network signaling, also is known as intercommunication between exchanges, that is between two PSTN switches. This is a signaling between the exchanges over trunk lines. Some typical signaling activities are the popular on-hook, off-hook, digits collections, ringing, ring-back and so on. What is the in-channel signaling or channel-associated signaling? Traditional signaling uses the same channel to carry voice information and also control information. This type of signaling is referred as in-channel signaling, also known as per-trunk signaling, PTS. It's also known as channel-associated signaling, CAS, per-trunk signaling, in-channel signaling, they all mean the same thing. What's a common channel signaling on the other hand, CCS? This is an alternative to in-channel signaling. CCS uses different channels for voice information and signaling information. That is, voice goes in a channel and signaling goes in an altogether different channel. It combines the signaling information of a number of channels together and sends them on a separate signaling channel. I go my way and you go your way. Signaling takes a different path and speech takes a different path. What are the four categories of in-channel signaling? Let's look at CIS categories. Refer to the figure. Loop disconnect, multi-frequency, voice frequency and PCM signalings are the four categories of CIS signaling. Let us look at all of them one by one in detail. Loop disconnect is also known as DC signaling. Refer to this figure that's on your screen now. This is a famous rotary dialer. If you dial 8, the rotary dial disconnects or connects your telephone with the exchange 8 times, and hence the term loop disconnect or DC signaling. That is, if I dial 8, 8 times the line is made and 8 times the line is broken. The DC loop between the user and the exchange is interrupted 8 times. One make break is known as one cycle, and therefore 8 such cycles happen. Each cycle's duration is 100 milliseconds. That is, the make and the break put together is 100 milliseconds. The speed of the dialer is 10 impulses per second. The figure gives you the complete details of speed, make to break ratio in detail. The old Strouger exchanges were geared to count the number of loop breaks and act appropriately. This type of signaling is, of course, obsolete these days. The second type of signaling is multi-frequency or AC signaling. Refer to the figure that is appearing on your screen now. This is a modern day DTMF, dual tone multi-frequency signaling. When a number is pressed, two separate tones are generated and sent to the local exchange, one after the other, in a very rapid succession. The figure shows the tones matrix in rows and columns and explains the tone selections clearly. Example, you press digit 1, a tone of 1209 cycles followed by another tone of 607 cycles is sent very rapidly, and the entire sequence is over in typically 40 milliseconds. In rotary dialing, the pulses are sent at a rate of 10 per second, that is 10 pulses per second, which means a digit 8 would take 0.8 seconds to dial out and a digit 0 will take 1 second to dial out. Very slow indeed. Whereas in tone dialing, 8 complete digits can be dialed in 1 second. It's quite rapid and has almost completely replaced the DC loop signaling throughout the world. Tone dialing is much faster and hence quicker call processing and increased productivity is possible. The extra keys, namely asterisk and hash, are also available in touchtone keypad, and this enables additional new features. The frequencies are within the voice band, of course. The third one is voice frequency signaling, also known as AC signaling. What is voice frequency signaling? The bandwidth of a typical telephone channel is 4000 Hz. The speech band occupies the bandwidth of 300 to 3400 Hz. If the signaling frequencies are chosen within the range of baseband telephone channel, then this type of signaling is referred as voice frequency signaling. How many types of voice frequency signaling are there? The voice frequency signaling are classified into two classes. They are in-band signaling and out-of-band signaling. What is in-band signaling? In-band signaling is the one in which if the control frequencies are within the speech band, that is between 300 to 3400 Hz, then this type of signaling is called in-band signaling. Typical spot frequencies would be 2280 cycles and 2600 cycles. As it uses the same frequency band such as voice between 300 to 3400 Hz, it must be protected against imitations of speech. For example, if your tone is around 2600 Hz and lasts for more than 50 milliseconds, the switching equipment determines it's not a speech component and it is a line disconnect signal. What are the advantages of in-band signaling? In-band signaling can be used on any transmission medium. It is very flexible and is widely used as a signaling system for long-distance telephone networks. It's also simple to implement. What could be the disadvantages of in-band signaling? Speech segments and the signaling may confuse each other at times. The in-band signal may spill over from one link to another link and cause errors in the signaling system. Let's move on to out-of-band signaling. What is out-of-band signaling? In this type of signaling, frequencies above the voice band of 3400 Hz but below the upper limit of 4000 Hz is used. The CC88T recommended frequency for out-of-band signaling is 3825 Hz, but 3700 Hz and 3850 Hz are also used. The out-of-band signaling is generally used in 4-wire E&M trunk. What is E&M trunk? 2 wires are meant for voice path, an E-lead and an M-lead with Eth ground returns. What are the advantages of out-of-band signaling? Signals and speech can be transmitted simultaneously without disturbing the conversation. Simple and consequently cheap. What could be the disadvantages of out-of-band signaling? Very narrow bandwidth is available for signaling. Filtering circuits are needed to separate voice and signaling bands. This filter design is quite stringent. The last type can be PCM, pulse code modulation signaling. PCM is a digital system employing time division multiplexing. PCM systems, speech and signaling are sampled at 8 kHz. And coded at the rate of 8 bits per sample, which results in 64 kilobits per second per channel or per user. There are two standards. They are DS1 24 channel system, North America and Japan, and European 30 channel system. DS1 is called T1 system. T1, this combines 24 channels at the rate of 64 kilobits per second. These 24 channels are combined into a single frame. Whereas in E1, 30 such channels are combined into each frame. Of course, each time slot will have 64 kilobits per second. In this slide, let's look at the call flow sequence. The calling party goes off hook, the hook switch of the telephone shorts both the wires and creates a loop all the way up to the telephone exchange. The exchange senses a DC loop. Since DC current flows through the loop, exchange acknowledges the calling party's request and extends a dial tone. The calling party starts dialing, either pulse dialing or TTMF tone dialing. Exchange collects the string of digits and analyzes them. Exchange locates where the called party is, it could be in any part of the world, and extends a ring signal to the called party through the distant exchange. Maybe a series of exchanges en route get involved in this. The distant exchange extends an alert signal to the called party whose telephone starts ringing. In the next step, local exchange extends a ring back tone, ring indication, to the calling party as well, just as an assurance that the call is under progress. The called party picks up the phone to answer the call. The alert signal to the calling party and ring back signal to the called party both are stopped. Both parties are ready now and they start speaking to each other. After the conversation is over, any one of the parties can disconnect by going on hook. This is sensed by the appropriate exchange, the local exchange or the distant exchange, and the call is disconnected. The billing for the entire duration of the call is computed and logged. This is a typical call flow that happens in a telephone conversation.